I am teaching this lesson on the gospel of Frankie Beverly. It's amazing. And I'm so glad. But anyway, let's get started. Father, thank you right now for all that you've done for bringing us here together. I thank you for all those who are watching. I thank you for all those who will watch this, maybe not today, but on another day. I thank you mostly, Father God, also for all the people who took the time and was able to come into this building, Father God, so that as a unit, we could worship together. So I thank you, Father God, that we still have the opportunity to share breath to breath, spirit to spirit, even in this space. I honor you for that. And I thank you, Father God, for the hearts of each of these people that you have touched, no matter where they are or how far, in Jesus' name. Amen. First slide, please. This one is called Beheading My Giants. Let's go. Read it with me. Then David said to the Philistine, "You come to me with a sword, a spear, and a javelin, but I come to you in the name of the Lord of hosts, the God of the armies of Israel, whom you have taunted. This day the Lord will deliver you up into my hands, and I will strike you down and remove your head from you." Well, what does it mean in ancient time when you think about this giant, whatever the giant is in your life? And you can come to that as we go through this lesson. But what does that mean? What does it mean to take off the head, to remove the head of the giant? Well, a head symbolizes power, authority, and honor. So what you're saying is whatever the giant is in your life, you're going to have to take the power away from it. You're going to have to take authority away from it. And whenever you hear the word honor, think value. So even when you hear the word of God will say, honor your parents, it means to value them. It means to place some significance on them. Weight, W-E-I-G-H-T. And so it's about an estimation of value. So think about that. Think about the things that keep us from going forward or can keep you from going forward. And sometimes the problem, the reason why it won't stop is because it still has value to you. So it still has power in it. But oftentimes we overcome the part where it has power. It's the value part. We still think we have some use for it. We still think it's going to do something for us because it did something for us before. And that makes sense to me. It makes sense to me. You know, I've shared with you all that, or at least I did, I think, in a workshop, about what happens when, and I was talking to them about something I'm going to do at the Women's Conference this year in October, and that is that you can leave what you no longer need. You can get rid of what you no longer need. See, when you was a child, there were things you needed, especially in a house with bully parenting, bully relatives. Listen, forget the bully people in the neighborhood. It's the ones inside the house. It's the one inside the family. It's the one that can come on the other side of that door. The other ones, because I used to be chased home from school, at least I could slam the door and lock them on the other side. But there are some things that you needed to survive that situation that you don't need anymore. You don't need that attitude. You don't need to go in the corner and think this out because somebody's over-talking you. You understand? That was me. I would go. People used to think, oh, you were so quiet. You used to stay in the house. No, I used to go in my room and sit there and separate myself from all of the voices, all of the opinions. I know that today. I don't have to do that now. I don't have to be afraid of your opinion. I don't have to run from your opinion. You understand? But that was necessary when that was happening in my life and I had no power. But now I'm the adult. I get to call the shots. There are some things you don't need anymore. And sometimes what we do is with those things is we try to demonize them. We try to hate them. Don't hate it because it helped you. You'll never hate it. Let me just say this. You'll hate it, and then as soon as you get in a tough spot, you go get it. Because it wasn't something that tried to destroy you. It's something that kept you until real love and real choice came into your life. The law kept us until Christ came. Some restrictions, some restraints, they kept us until Christ came, until the Christ came into our lives, the Spirit of truth came into our lives and set us free. Now we are free to make decisions that we weren't free to make then. So you got to be Hedges Giant now. And that's not talk. That's a real fight. But it's not a physical fight. Notice what he said to them. He says, you have come with spear, sword, spear, and javelin. He's saying, you're coming with worldly weapons here. That's how you're trying to come against me. But until you understand that your war is not against the flesh, then the real war that's keeping the giants powerful and authoritative and weighty in your life is because it's in your spirit. Listen, set your mind free and the rest of your body will follow it. You can have somebody in jail, in prison, or whatever they're going through, and you can let them out, and they will still take that prison, poverty, fearful, get over, I got the high food mentality with them. And they're clearly free, physically. But I don't care how physically free you are, if your mind is in captivity. This is why anxieties and addictions and all those things that Deron talk about his way. This is why he talks about it. Because if you don't get set free from the inside out, you'll just find another prison. It'll be comfortable for you to imprison yourself. It will be comfortable for you to separate yourself from people. Because that worked for me. That worked for you. Being quiet when you had something to say worked for you when you was in a situation with somebody who just talked too much and then didn't let you get your stuff in. I remember when Toledo was younger and a relative, well, a adult relative, I wrote in my book, From the Hood to Harvard. You can download it on Amazon.com. But anyway, when Toledo was younger, and that's just cheesy, but anyway, when Toledo was younger, you know, this adult would just kind of have certain conversations with her. But they would call her skinny, and then she would call them fat. Then they would come and tell me she's rude. So I said, Lita, why are you calling? You know, listen, they don't like that. That hurts them, their feelings. You know what she said to me? And when they say that I'm skinny, the way that they talk to say that I'm skinny, that hurts my feelings too. I feel like they're saying something is wrong with me too. So after I had a few of those kind of incidents, this is what I told the adult. Do me a favor. Do not play with her this way, because when you invite her into your adult world and then she start acting like a child who has no boundaries, you pull out your adult card. You disrespected me. Don't bring her into that room. She can't handle it. As much as she, okay, the truth is you can't handle it, right? She has no boundaries. She's not afraid of what you, she has the experience. She don't even know this stuff hurts somebody feeling. But sometimes we live with those people who use that Trump card. And I'm not talking about President Trump. I'm talking about your parents and those guardians and those people. They use that card. And they didn't let you say as much to them, express your feelings like they could express theirs. Express your feelings the way they express theirs. So you got to behead that giant. You don't need it no more. Next slide. Now you got to behold his honor. Now you got to put value. You got to switch value now. Let's read it. And I will give the dead bodies of the army of the Philistines this day to the birds of the sky and the wild beasts of the earth, that all the earth may know that there is a God in Israel, and that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not deliver by sword or by spear. For the battle is the Lord's, and he will give you into our hands. Now listen to this. He's saying, behold. You know another word for behold is witness. He says this. When I go through my trial, I'm going to do it in front of you. I'm going to do it in front of you so that you will know. And I'm going to do it in front of you, and I'm going to honor the Lord. I'm not going to fuss. I'm not going to fall out. I'm not going to talk about you. I'm not going to go back and forth with you, because there are some witnesses. There are some people watching. And they will see that this one right here, I will not win with that fight I have. That's why you ain't seen that fight. Oh, no, no, I will behold your glory this time. The other times, I threw a little few of my weapons in there. I pulled out my sword at times. David said, this is what I'm going to do. And everybody in the assembly going to know that the Lord don't win his battles using jealousy, using blame, judgment. No. That's not how he delivers. Listen to this. Now listen, pay attention. He says that all the assembly may know that the Lord does not deliver by sword. He said, I don't use one worldly method to deliver you. I deliver you from the inside out. There's nothing on your outside. There's nothing in your flesh that I will ever use to deliver you. So let the world see, soul factory, that the Lord don't need your arguments. He don't need your rage. He doesn't need our fussing. He needs our humility. And watch some people get saved. Watch him deliver some people. When you decide to honor him over those old weapons that used to work. Come on now, my weapon worked. I backed many people off of me with this mouth, with this mind, with this wit. But today, I'm going to see your glory. I want to see it. I want to know it. So I'm taking the power away from that giant. I'm cutting his head off now. No more authority over this mouth, this life, this heart, this gift. And I will no longer give you honor in my life. How do I know you have honor in my life? Because I keep doing it. That's all I know. Because I think it works. That means it's valuable to me. Come on now, you're only holding that in your pocket because you think it's going to do something for you. Why does anybody hold on to the last cigarette or the last this or whatever your last thing you may be hanging on? Why does anybody hold on to something just in case? Because it still has some level of value to you. I will remove the honor when I cut off your head. Why is that? Because you will no longer be my head, my power nor my authority. He says, listen, I told you, another word for beholding is witnesses. It says, we're going to allow the assembly to see the power. Don't you get scared. I'm nervous about more than a few things. But I ain't bringing all. There's something I ain't going to bring in. I've got to wait on the Lord. I've got to wait on the Lord. Listen, how will you show this power to the assembly? If you give in to shame, blame, accusation, judgment, arguments, point proven, power, authority, and honor in this life. How? How? When you use shame, you use some other kind of weapon. That's not the Lord's weapon. When you use blame, that's not the Lord's weapon. When you get into accusations and judgments, all of these are anti-love words. All of these words are. What does shame do? Make you high, put you in bondage. What do blame do? Lock you up. What do accusation do? Put you in jail. What do judgment do? Put you in jail. What do arguments do? Put you in jail. What does point proving do? Put you in prison. What does it do? That's totally against the principle of love. If I put any kind of yoke on you, it's not love. Tell me the accusation is not for the point of you putting a yoke on somebody. If we would just be honest about it. Tell me that blame isn't that you're trying to put the yoke on somebody. Tell me that shame ain't you putting the yoke on you. It is. So I'm going to show this assembly. No blame. No shame. No accusations. No judgment. No arguments. No point proven. Because that ain't where the power is. That pseudo power is false. You'll win an argument and lose the war. You'll win an argument and then you're separated. You win an argument and then you're not friends anymore. You win an argument and the very thing that God wants is connection. It'll create the opposite of what God wants. And now you're disconnected over an argument? I said, I know that you can't survive. You can't survive disconnected. If I cut my hand off right now and put it in the same room with me, it would die in front of me because it needs the life of my blood to keep it moving. It needs my lifeline to keep it moving and to make it useful. It could be right in the room with me. So if I deem that you have nothing to give and I treat you like you have nothing to give and I keep you in a state of disconnection, you will die right in front of me. Or you're going to come become some kind of prosthetic arm or limb. And guess what we know? You can't pick up nothing. I mean, today some technology may let you clamp with a few things, but the other little doll baby hands style. Listen, it helps you. It helps you look good. It helps you look normal. But can you use it? It has its use in making you look whole. Don't you be laughing at me. It has its use in making you look whole. But will it function? Will it grab things for you? No. Is that the kind of life you want? To have some gifts, some things, some parts of the body that God gave to you, and you never benefit from it? Is that what you want? To be a part of the body, yet be no benefit to the body? That's called dead dying. If the Lord does not save with the sword or with the spirit, then how does the Lord save? That's what he's saying in here. Listen. And that all this assembly may know that the Lord does not deliver, as in save, by sword or spirit. And then how does he do it? How does he do it? Because that's what you're looking for. That's what you're going to find. That's where you're going to find that thing that will bring life to you again. Next slide. What does he use? Your testimony. Sharing my testimony. Listen, still in 1 Samuel 17, David said, "The Lord who rescued me from the paw of the lion and from the paw of the bear, he will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine." The only thing that David cared about in his past is what the Lord did. How about that? Come on, victims. He said, David didn't say, in the line, y'all ain't see what he did to me. I was scratched here. She took out a chunk of my butt, my foot, and my big toe gone. Listen, the Lord who rescued me from them will do it tomorrow. He did it yesterday. He can do it tomorrow. That's the only testimony. Let the assembly hear that. Give your assembly a testimony and don't tell me who you used to be, because you was nothing when God found you. It ain't make no difference that you was nothing then. You wasn't something then. He never chose you because you was something. He chose you because you was missing a whole bunch of stuff and he knew that he had some space in your heart because you would call out to him. He said, I did not come for the righteous. I came for the sick. I didn't come for the healthy. I came for the sick. So if God got any kind of hold of you, you may have forgotten about it, but you were sick. Y'all think that doctor doesn't visit. Listen, that doctor is not confused. That doctor knows who's really sick. And he knows who knows they are sick. Because every night, somewhere, some kind of way, they're crying out to him. Whether it be by words or sadness. Depression or frustration, addiction, all of that is a call out to be whole. Because addiction is there because you actually want connection, community, and to be whole. You don't feel right. You went and tried something. You had authority over it by choice. Now it has authority over you. But you took it because there was a feeling that you wanted. And I'm not saying the feeling was on the inside. I'm saying maybe you wanted the people in the group to like you. Maybe you tried it, didn't even have a taste for it. But maybe somebody got you in that space because you wanted to belong. That's why the body is about believing and belonging. But belonging isn't chilling. It's belonging. Belonging isn't coming for as if this is entertainment. It is being a part. He will rescue me from the hand of this Philistine. So I ain't got to go back and look at none of my skills, as David is saying. My skills didn't do that. These skills, my skills as a shepherd didn't do this. But I could fight a little bit. Next one. So you got to get your testimony. What was that? Stay right there. You got to share my testimony. What's the next piece? Using my tools. Read it with me. Then Saul dressed David in his garments and put a bronze helmet on his head and put a coat of mail armor on him. Then David fastened his sword over his armor and tried to walk, but he could not because he was not used to them. And David said to Saul, I cannot go with these because I am not used to them. So David took them off. What are your tools? Use your tools. You have tools. You have things that you can use. Let me use. What is a device? What is a tool? So I can get you on my mindset page. It's a device used to carry out a particular function. What is your tools? What are your tools? Come on now. Somebody arguing back with you, for you, use your tools. What are your tools? The word of God is your tool. The word of God is your tool. Use your tools. Don't use Saul tools. Don't use the world tools. Don't use the Google God's tools. Don't use the Facebook prophet's tools. Do you understand? Use your tools. And you're not expected to know how to use my tools. If my tools are too much for you, use your tools. But I guarantee you, this teaching tool comes from God. That evangelism tool comes from God. That pastor tool comes from God. That prophet tool comes from God. Use your tools, your gift. Use it. You can't do nothing with somebody else's stuff. But that also doesn't mean that you are independent from me. You need these gifts. He said, I cannot go with these because I'm not used to. What are you used to? Don't you ever believe you can do what I do because I look comfortable doing it. You won't get hurt. You better like rejection. Okay, let me say this. You better know how to deal with rejection. Nobody likes it. You better be ready for people to accuse you. You better be ready for people to try to trap you in your words. Because when ain't nobody saying nothing, ain't nobody got nothing to say to you because you ain't saying nothing. But when you in the front, you saying something, now everybody get ideas. I get it. Some people get inspired. Some people get inspired like an honest man, but some people get inspired like a crook. They hear it and they use it in a crooked way. They use it to accuse, to persecute, to trap you. But some people use it for elevation. Promotion. Listen, you don't need to demote me to be promoted. You don't need to put me down to be promoted. God got enough for everybody. The earth is the Lord's and the fullness thereof. He has enough for everybody. You ain't got to worry about somebody taking something that belong to you. What's that? They try to pull that on John the Baptist. Y'all know y'all got the teaching here today. They try to pull that on John the Baptist. And they told John the Baptist, Jesus, this man over here, he's baptizing more people to you. John said, no, wait, let me tell you something. I already told you when he comes, I'm going to back up. I know my place and I know his place. And what he what he's doing doesn't cancel out my usefulness. It just means the thing that I can show you on the outside, he's going to do that kind of work on the inside. I'm going to baptize you with water, but he's going to baptize you with fire from the inside. All I'm telling you is what he's going to do different for me is that he's more effective. But I'm not obsolete. Because all I got to do my part and finish my work, stay on my path. You don't want this. Teachers will be judged more strictly. Don't try it. Unless you're ready. to ride that kind of wave. You're going to be like, what's the evangelist? I'm going to call him the evangelist. Jonah. Jonah go out there, preach, go and preach the word to somebody, the doom. And when he found out that God was compassionate, and that once people, listen, y'all, people who mad at somebody, once they cry out to God, God's compassion, God said, come on, Jonah. You misunderstood me. I'm not doing this out of destruction. This is love. My goal is that they get set free. Parents, when you discipline children, it's not for the point of hurting them. That's why you should instruct them. Because what you're trying to do is free them from that spirit you see on them. But don't add to the spirit of abuse with punches and bunches. This is what we do. That's why he can say, turn this man over to Satan so Satan can teach him not to blaspheme, so that in the end, his flesh would be chastised, but his spirit would be saved. It's always about freedom, salvation, and setting the captives free. That's what it's about. Even when you're dealing with your children, even when I'm talking to you, even when we disagree, even when you don't understand me, love must always be the driving force. And love sets everybody free. The goal is to set the captive free. What did Jesus come to do? Set the captives free. Next one. After you use your tools, remember your training. I got to remember my training. Listen, read it with me. Then he took his shepherd's staff in his hand and chose for himself 5 smooth stones out of the stream bed and put them in his shepherd's bag, which he had, that is, in his shepherd's pouch, with his thing in his hand. You know what? That pouch used to just be there just in case. It was a common part of the shepherd's equipment. But it was David's training as a shepherd that had him to remember, wait a minute, I'm trained to use this pouch. It's time now. He used his training as a shepherd. See, we think about the 5 smooth stones, but it talked about the pouch first. Talked about the pouch. Use your training. You about to fight your giant? Don't forget everything we taught you. You about to fight your giant? Use your training. You've been prepared for this. You've been prepared for this. You've been prepared for conversations that don't go your way. You've been prepared for this. You've been prepared to know what Deron called the 7, 8, 9, 10 stings. You've been prepared for this. That this discouragement, it's got to be about 7 of them. You remember? What else? One was discouraged. That's why, what's the other one? Discouragement, despair, and 5 other ones. Okay? But my point is, that was told to us over and over and over and over. I was tired of it. Now that I need to remember it, I can't remember it. But when he got up there, I was like, I feel in my own blanks. You ain't got to tell me this again. But it don't matter when you fill it in the blanks on the paper. It matters now. It matters when it's time to behead your giant. It matters when you have a giant that's keeping you to love the assembly the way God told us to. Come on now. Then he took his shepherd's staff in his hand. He knew how to use that staff. He was trained. Use your training. Use your training. Next slide. Living the truth. Play my. This is my Frankie Beverly song, and then I'll get to the slide. Take that down. Play my song, my video song, whatever you want to do. It's just true. But listen, let me just give you the first few lines. She said, "Listen, love is the key to life. the thing that makes it right. Why we can't be one, I'll never know. Love is the key this time, and there's no doubt in my mind. If you really want to be free, love is the key. Now let Frankie do it.
Well, talking about love.
Hashtag, the gospel of Frankie Beverly is amazing. But the fruit of the Spirit, the result of his presence within, is love. First one, love. What is that? Unselfish concern for others. There we go. Read it with me. But the fruit of the Spirit, the result of his presence within us, is love. Unselfish concern for others. Listen. Remember, we're talking about how are you going to get here? How is Jesus going to deliver you without physical weapons? You're going to have to respect the teacher. That's the Holy Spirit. You're going to have to respect the teacher. Put it back up so we can finish reading, please. But the fruit of the Spirit, the result of his presence within us, is love, unselfish concern for others, joy, inner peace, patience, not the ability to wait, but how we act while waiting. Come on now. Kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Now that's where we lose it right there. Everything we can sing like Frankie Beverly, that love is the key, goodness, self-control, it's where you lose it. You got to master your emotions here. This is the one fruit of the Spirit that some folks just can't seem to get. And I ain't judge you because it took me a long time. Because I ain't honor and I ain't value what I was supposed to be valuing. I value my point over God's presence. Come on now. Some of you us value people over God's presence. So we people please. Listen to this. Goliath was a giant in God's way, in love's way, in truth's way. What is your giant that's in God's way? Oh, no, no. Don't make whatever people think God is. We talking about a spirit. And God, for everybody who knows, is a title. Okay. If he gave you a description of himself, he would use the word compassion, slow to anger. That's what those are the terms that should stay. When you hear God, you should hear compassion, slow to anger, abounding in love. You should hear those kind of things. But listen, Goliath was a giant in God's way. Do you have any giants that need to be beheaded? Do you have any giants that's in God's way, love's way, truth's way? Nobody can do this one for you. These giants have, how do you know they're giants? They got too much power. How you know they're giant? They got too much authority. How you know they're giant? They got too much value over God, over God's word, over your ability to love sincerely. I wrote this on the blog. This statement here on the blog, and it says this: how does one typically leave the path, lose their way, or find themselves on a crooked path? Because he or she allows hurt to speak louder than God's command to love. Your hurt voice is much louder than God's command to love. And because love must be sincere, anybody want to be authentic? The word of God will lead you to authenticity. Because love must be sincere, that's authentic. The Lord instructs us on how to keep our way pure, authentic. How does a young man keep his way pure? By living according to my word. How do you get to authenticity? Let the source tell you how you built. Let the source tell you how to use your heart. Let the source of life tell you how to use your mind. Let the source of type light tell you how to use your emotions. Let the source of life tell you how to use your speech. Let the source of light tell you how to use your body. And you'll find yourself being authentic without even trying. Because his presence will keep you in truth. Because the same spirit, that the same teacher that you're going to respect is also the spirit of truth. So what are you really going to retract? The teacher? No, the spirit of truth. Same thing. Next slide. Respecting the teacher. We already talked about that. It says this: it was for this freedom that Christ set us free, completely liberating us. Therefore, keep standing firm and do not be subject again to a yoke of slavery, which you once removed. You once removed it. But when we once remove something and we remove it from the surface and we don't remove it from the default, it returns, right? I've been telling the same scenario, this example for years. If you make some changes in a document, and you don't save it, it goes back to whatever it was before you made one change. Don't let that be you. Don't be an unsaved document. Next slide. What's the next piece? You gotta care about reaching a goal. Read it with me. as I urged you when I went into Macedonia. Stay there in Ephesus so that you may be command certain men not to teach false doctrines any longer, nor to devote themselves to myths and endless genealogies. These promote controversies rather than God's work, which is by faith. The goal of this command is love, which comes from a pure heart and a good conscience. You say, anything you get ready to do, Shamir, if I see you getting ready to get into something, then love for you should want to snatch you out the fire. That's love. But if you care more about the snatching part, then you're not going to see the love. The book of Jude says some people you got to snatch out of the fire. They so foolish. Somebody turn to Jude and find that for me so I can get you to read it. It's Jude. Jude is only one chapter. So you ain't going to search hard, and it's towards the end, okay? And it's in the back of the book, y'all. So, but listen. The goal of the command to confront false teachers, the goal of the command for him to devote him to talk to those who are going on and on about endless genealogies. I come from this, you come from that, we come from this, she come from that. I'm from the earth, from the sky, you from the sea. My horoscope is this, your horoscope is that. I'm this animal, you that animal. Listen, but when it comes to these false doctrines, see, there's sometimes people are doing things and they only live into their highest truth. They don't even know that what they're doing is destructive. And if God should send you to them, your desire, your goal, the outcome of you going to anybody is in hopes that you can set them free from the power of captivity that leads to purposelessness. That you would, listen, if you see somebody who's about to be disconnected, terribly disconnected, this is what I know. See, I know this. I know that if I cut off my hand and put it in the same room, it will die if it's not connected to me. That is not my logic. That is the truth from the Creator. He said, if you want to know me, you can learn. You can learn from the things that I've made. You can look at my creation to know me. You're going to learn about me, the unseen things, through the seen things. Look at the seen things, and then look at the seen things, the rituals, and then see the spiritual reality in it. What's the spiritual reality? That's why God hates divorce. He's just talking about separation. Because when you separate from me, you die. When the blood ain't flowing anymore to any part of your body, it dies. Is that true, doctor? There you go. Dr. Long will tell you. That's why we gangrene and all these different things, because circulating things can't circulate. Guess what? It begins to decay. And I know, listen, ain't nobody so full that they could get what they've gotten so far and never turn back. Solomon was the wisest man during his time, and he flipped. He flipped. There is no wisdom that is powerful enough for the everlasting purposes of Satan. Satan been here a whole lot longer. And he done dealt with all kinds of people. He has a whole lot more training than us. But when we stay connected and that blood flows and it covers us, the angel of death cannot have us. Nor our purpose, nor our gift, nor our love, nor our life. But when you separate yourself, you remove that blood from the door. You disconnect from that covering. That was a covering on the door. That wasn't just a stain. That was purposeful. Don't let your emotions tell you stuff. The fruit of the Spirit starts with love, but it ends with self-control. Because I think at the end of the day, that's where we are. It's the end of the day. I done this. I done been kind. I done some goodness. I done loved somebody. I done gave somebody a dollar to get some McDonald's. They begging on the street. Now I'm telling you to control yourself. You're home, you're tired, the people on the job done got on your nerve. Control yourself. Don't go in your house and destroy. Watch your impulses. Get to know yourself. What has God brought together in any kind of way that he wants it to be separated in a destructive way? He said, let nobody take the things that God says connects and call them something else. Because that's not my goal. My goal is to set free, but I know you cannot be free as an individual. That's not true. You got to be free within. Your hand can be free to do what it's going to do, but cut it off and see if it do this. No. It's your connection that's keeping you alive. It's keeping you alive. Reaching a goal. The goal of whatever you're going to do from here on out, let it be love. If it ain't love, don't do it. If it ain't love, it's not your assignment. If you're trying to hurt somebody, put them in prison, If it's your assignment, that's only because you crossed over and now God is using your darkness for his purposes. You don't want that. That's what Judas was. What's the next slide? Number 9. Receiving the gift. Read it with me. Jesus answered him, Simon, I have something to tell you. To me, teacher, he said, two men owed money to a certain money lender. One owed him 500 denarii and the other 50. Neither of them had the money to pay him back, so he canceled it. Listen. Why are you chasing people down about your sins, about their sins and their offenses? Why you want to put them in prison? You ain't got enough money to pay your debt. You broke two broke people trying to choke each other out. Neither of them had the money to pay him back. Who you want to pay? You ain't got the money yourself. So he canceled the debts of both of them. Both of them mean something. So he can say to you, and I cancel your debt too. Now, which of them will love him more? Simon replied, I suppose the one who had the bigger debt canceled. You have judged correctly, Jesus said. See, because love must be sincere, because it must be sincere, God has to get us to the point where we're dealing in truth. And the truth is, I just don't know why we think that somebody did something, we did nothing. I just don't understand. But until we get there, love won't be the key. What's the next one? Become a giver. Pull up the next one. Read it with me. Then he turned toward the woman and said to Simon, do you see this woman? I came into your house. You did not give me any water for my feet, but she wet my feet with her tears and wiped them with her hair. You did not give me a kiss, but this woman, from the time I entered, has not stopped kissing my feet. You did not put oil on my head, but she has poured perfume on my feet. Therefore, I tell you, her many sins have been forgiven, for she loved much. But he who has been forgiven little loves little. Said, let me tell you something. Your little love giving says back to me that I ain't forgive you for much. So which your choices are putting a certain value on me. You're saying I ain't do much. You're saying I ain't pay that big bill. Because your goal is to live in my purpose and give according to what has been given. Listen, I'm going to read 2 Corinthians 8, 11 through 12. Listen to this. It says this. Listen, 2 Corinthians 8, 11 through 12. It's not on your papers. Now finish the work so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your completion of it. See, stop getting excited. Stop using your emotions like that. Girl, I can't wait. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. Come on now. Don't oversell. Don't oversell. Finish the work so that your eager willingness to do it may be matched by your completion. You ever had somebody who was eager when they were saying it, when they were talking about it? But now when they come around, they got 100 excuses. Where's all that excitement you had? I was depending on you based on your excitement. Verse 12, for if the willingness is there, the gift is acceptable according to what one has, not according to what he does not have. So he said, listen, I'll accept your gift. If the willingness is there, then the gift is acceptable. But I don't want your angry service. Listen, if you don't want to do it, don't do it. The Lord says, now I ain't telling you that. I probably still want you to do it. If you don't want to do it, he's saying, listen, then somebody got to push you up the hill. Y'all know women. Men, I thought you said you was going to fix the toilet. Well, I was going to fix the toilet. But then so-and-so, I was witnessing to them out in the parking lot. We was praying. The Holy Ghost came down. Well, the Holy Ghost came down first when you told me you was going to do something. The Holy Ghost don't need to keep you from keeping your word. Because that's another sin. You should see how many souls saved. Guess how many souls ain't delivered in your own household. Because you out there taking care of everybody else. So keep your word. The gift is acceptable according to what you have. So God said, don't come trying to oversell yourself, trying to get somebody what you ain't got. Oh, I can do it. I can do it. I ain't never done this before. I can do it. Okay, anybody else? But I'm willing. You got to be skilled. You need some ability. You need some training. You need some trials. You need some overcoming. Come on now. They don't put a rookie on the front line unless they want to kill him. But you don't put a rookie on the front line. How do you know? Because David, when he was cheating with a man's wife, put that rookie on the front line because he wanted to kill him. You don't put no rookie on the white line, front line. You go get a soldier. And a soldier ain't a soldier who's been here for a long time. It's somebody who can master their emotions and take them giants down. Their own personal giants first. Next one. After you become a giver, leave your past. Listen, read it with me. The way we set a person, a spirit free, is choosing an attitude of forgiveness over the one that insists on someone paying. Psalms, read it with me, 49, 7 through 8. We're going to read this three times so we can lock it in the pocket. Come on now. It reads this, listen, read it go. No man can redeem the life of another or give to God a ransom for him. The ransom for a life is costly. No payment is ever enough. Read it again. No man can redeem the life of another or give to God a ransom for him. The ransom for a life is costly. No payment is ever enough. Read it again. No man can redeem the life of another or give to God a ransom for him. The ransom for a life is costly. No payment is ever enough. I don't care how much I give you, it'll never be enough. If you don't already feel accepted by the Lord, if you are insecure, if you are hell-bent on rejection, I can't do anything because the first place of acceptance is with the presence within. Listen, somehow we think loving ourselves comes from a different source. I got to love myself. Well, if you was ever loving God, you will be loving yourself. There's no other place for loving yourself. It's the same room. Listen, it's the same room. You think you got to go out of the room, roll your eyes at somebody in this room, and go out there and get love. It's right here. And if I'm not loving you, I'm not loving myself. If I don't love you, Ed, I am not loving myself. I am not disconnected from you enough. I die if you die. Because we're one body. I am held up if you are held up. If you are my arm and I got to run a race, I ain't going to win, Ed. Because I need two arms to fight to win. I need two arms to propel me to win. So to love you is to love me. So stop letting people tell you, I got to love myself and separate from somebody. That's a trick. It's a trick. One God, one love. Ain't nowhere else to go and get it. It's the same room. It's the same thing. Gift of the Spirit, as we said, with self-control. I don't need to read that. Here's what I want to say. When we don't exercise mastery over our emotions, our emotions choose a path for us that seems right. There's a way that seems right to a man that leads to destruction. Death of your purpose. Death of your call. It seems right, but it's not right. It feels right, but it's not righteous. It feels right to not want to be hurt and let your ego fend for you. It feels right to use those other weapons, but it leads to destruction. It'll kill you because it'll run everybody out of your life. And unfortunately, in the name of looking for love, we do crazy things like push people away. In the name of wanting somebody to come close. Listen, you want somebody to come close to you? Watch your mouth. You want somebody to come close to you? Show some love. Show proper care for someone. And they, the God in them, will gladly draw near to you. Draw near to me and I draw near to you. God said, draw near to me and I draw near to you. It's the same love. Now that you know it ain't no separate space. When I draw near, he draws near. When I go forward, the truth in me comes forward. But come on now. You are not going to, you want some to catch some flies? Throw some out. Okay, don't throw honey. You want to catch something sweet? Or you want to catch something? You're going to have to use some honey, honey. Don't let that devil trick you and make you think that you're going to keep insulting people and they're going to want to talk to you. It's not going to happen. It's not going to happen. That's not the weapon. Love is the key this time. It's the thing that makes it right. Love makes this all right. It's crazy if I don't have love to lead me. It doesn't make sense if I don't do it in love. If I speak in tongues of men and of angels but have not love, I am only a noisy, resounding gong or a clanging cymbal. If I have the gift of prophecy and can fathom all mysteries and all knowledge, and if I have faith that can move a mountain but have not love, I am nothing. If I give all I possess to the poor and surrender my body to the flame but have not love, I gain nothing. Love is the key to life. It is the thing that's going to make it right. So if you really want to be free, love is the key. Hashtag the gospel of Frankie Beverly. Leave the past. Leave the past. Forgive. Lastly, embrace the presence. Listen, notice I put the presence and not the present. Embrace the presence. Now that you have purified, read it with me. Now that you have purified yourselves by obeying the truth. Hold on, no. Who purified you? How do you get pure? But who did it? You did it. You did it. You did it by obeying the truth, but God did it by giving you the truth. Exposing you to truth. Exposing you to the light. Let's go again. Now that you have purified yourself by obeying the truth, so that you have sincere love for your brother. Oh, no, there's that giant right there. What truth was he talking about? Love. What was the goal? Love. When you obey truth, you come. It makes you authentic. Your love becomes more sincere. He didn't just say love. He said sincere love. That's why you need an authentic woman in your life. Somebody who's going to be real with you, whether you like it or not. Obey the truth so that you have sincere love for your brothers. Love one another deeply from the heart. For you have been born again. Stay out your past. You know, you have been born again, not of perishable seed. That's gone. Let me say this. That's there too. But you got to turn that noise down. You got to take the value away from your flesh and put the value and the honor on the spirit. For you, read it, 23. For you have been born again, not of perishable seed, but of imperishable through the living and enduring word of God. That's how you've been born again. So where are you going to look for your truth? Huh? Where are you trying to get that from? Huh? Is it the living and enduring? Did you stay out of other people's books? Go to God's book. You know what other people's books, know what they're good for? You know what happens when I write a book? I write it from the way I see things. I don't have the only way to see things, apparently. Somebody's going to say it another way. But God's going to say it a way that all of us can live with. I'll end with this. The song Black Butterfly. Do you feel like a caged bird or free butterfly? Listen to this. Black Butterfly sailed across the water. Now, you know you're talking about slavery, right? Okay. But now, you know you're talking about physical slavery, but now I'm talking about spiritual slavery. Okay? Black Butterfly sailed across the water. Tell your sons and daughters what the struggle brings. Take that giant down in front of them and tell them how you slayed that giant. Tell them how you took the authority and the power away from that giant. Tell them how you used to value this, but I don't value that anymore. Tell them how destructive that was and how life-giving and enduring the word of God was when you use your tool. Black Butterfly, set the skies on fire. Rise up even higher so the ageless winds of time can catch your wings. Rise up higher. What are you doing? While you slept, the promise was unkept when you were sleeping. Okay, wait a minute. While you slept, the promise was unkept, but your faith was as sure as the stars. Now you're free, and the world has come to see just how proud and beautiful you are. That is what God wants to see. Glorify me. The world is coming to see your star. The world is coming to see how proud and beautiful you are. But you are only going to be proud and beautiful after you have sailed across the waters. And you survived the ship. And you survived the oppression. And you came out with your right mind. How dare you go and eat the king's delicacies and get caught up? And go out there and warn him what your slave master made you pay for his family to have. How dare we get caught up in that? You go tell your children. Tell the future what the struggle brings. Don't tell them go how to do their lashes. Why they know how to do their lashes and their nails and their toes and don't have any idea of what the struggle brings? What is this? Let's behead some giants. I don't know if anybody else is ready for this, but I know you all are. Because I know what your tools and your training is like. Because I'm the teacher. I know you've been trained. I know you know better. I know we better than this. And I'll die believing this even if you don't. I'll go to my grave saying, I know they were better than this. I'll never give up on you. And I'll never stoop down and bow to the God because you bow to it. I'll always point you to the stars. Why is that? Because when you come through, the world's going to want to see something. You know why I know? Because you want to see me. You want to see somebody who overcame. Please know I'm not saying that as if it's a hierarchy or boasting. I'm saying that when you come through, God puts that lamb on the table and not under the table. He puts it so the world can see it. You are the salt of the earth and the light of the world. What are you doing? What are you doing? Let's pray. Father, in Jesus' name, here we are. You have redeemed us. You have called us. You have loved us. You have washed us. You have restored us. You have redeemed us. You have saved us. You have delivered us. You have spoke to us. You have guided us. You have taught us. And now, Father, let us honor you with our lives, with all that we do, with our giving, with our receiving, with our respecting you, with our honoring you. Father, is anybody in this room who has stepped aside from you? Speak to their heart, Father God, the way that you know that they hear. I declare to you, Father God, that there's no one in this room who we don't have use for. Everybody in this room, we have use for. Encourage them, Father God, with your Holy Spirit, your presence that is within, so that the willing and the doing would match each other. In your glorious name we pray. Amen. Amen. And amen.